No.
No. So remember, you cannot intentionally trip any player. And the key word here is intentional. So it has to be an intentional act against an opponent. And if you see that, it's a 15-yard penalty for tripping. K punts, and during the return, R44 initiates forcible contact with his shoulder against K66 from the blind side. Is this a legal block?
No.
No.
No. So this is a blindside block, but I don't want you to think that all blindside blocks are illegal. You can legally block from the blindside, but you have to lead with open hands. And so in this question, if you get this type of question on the exam, we have forcible contact initiated with the shoulder. And so that's the cue that this is an illegal block. All right. During a dead ball period, Team A's assistant coach is flagged for unsportsmanlike conduct due to cursing the official while standing by the numbers. This is Team A's second unsportsmanlike conduct during the game. The first was assigned to the head coach. Ruling. The head coach is disqualified and must leave the field. He must also remain out of view of the playing area. Is this true or false?
False.
False.
What makes this false?
Because we have a clear person to pin it on other than the head coach. There's no sideline implications or anything. This is on someone specifically other than the head coach.
Correct. We can clearly identify who is cussing us from the numbers. All right. Now, what are we going to do with that assistant coach? Are we going to allow him to remain coaching?
No.
No. We are not going to allow an assistant coach to come out on the field and cuss at us. So we're going to flag him, and he is going to be disqualified. He's going to have to leave the field. And are we going to be concerned about where he goes once we eject him? Once he leaves the coach, once he leaves the team box, are we going to worry about where he goes?
No.
No. If we see him in the stands later in the game, what are we going to do?
Nothing.
Nothing.
We're going to put it on the injection report. All right. We're not going to go stop the game and make, you know, have him escorted out of the stadium. Just we're going to put it on the game report, and we're going to let the high school league determine what they want to do with that coach.
So why are you ejecting the coach? I'm confused.
Because he's cussing. We're not going to let an assistant coach come out on the field and cuss at us.
Well, that's unsportsmanlike. It's just a foul.
We're going to – I mean, you can do that if you want to, but I'm going to say that's flagrant, and I'm going to inject an assistant coach.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, that's – a head coach gets a little bit more leeway, but assistant coaches – and that comes from Jerome. I mean, that comes from the high school league. If he talks to us – that's one of the things he always says is, you know, head coaches get leeway, assistant coaches do not.
I concur. That was also my mantra when I was a wing official. I take a whole lot off of head coach, but not any assistant.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Fourth and 10 from K's 5. R77 blocks K's punt, and the ball bounces into K's end zone. K21 bats the ball from the end zone over the end line. Ruling, no penalty options for R. Play results in a safety. Is this true or false?
True.
Is K guilty of a foul on this play?
Yes.
Yes. So this is an illegal bat, but because it occurred in the end zone and the play, in the result of the play, was a safety, and penalty enforcement would be from the end zone. Thus, there's no options. So it's a safety all the way around. So there's still a foul on the play, but there's just no options for R in this case. Question number five. A1 throws a forward pass to A22. A22 catches the pass behind A's line of scrimmage and throws a forward pass to A80 beyond A's line of scrimmage. B21 contacts A80 prior to the ball arriving, preventing A80 from catching the pass, ruling defensive pass interference. True or false?
False.
Why is this false?
Illegal forward pass.
Right. So you had two forward passes. So it doesn't matter where the first forward pass is called. What matters is if it went forward or backwards. And if it goes forward and then they throw another one, then you have an illegal forward pass. So you cannot have defensive pass interference. What are some of the fouls you can't have? Can you have an eligible downfield? Nope. Could you have? Can you have roughing the passer on the second?
Nope.
Unless it's flagrant.
You can have a personal foul, but you cannot have roughing the passer. Okay.
Couldn't have illegal touching either. If this guy was covered up or whatnot, then.
Oh, yep. You can't have illegal touching. So. The key to being able to officiate this, if you see this on the field, and this is something that you can see, if they try to throw a double pass and they mess up the first pass, the kid's not smart enough not to throw it. Coach told me to throw it, I'm going to throw it. So the key to understanding this and officiating is knowing if that first pass was backward or forward. And so if you're the back judge and you see B21 contact A80, and he prevents him from catching the pass, I fully expect there to be a flag for defensive pass interference because the back judge isn't going to know. But then we have to get together as a crew and discuss this and be like, wait a minute, the first pass was forward. The second pass was forward. That makes that pass illegal. So we can't have defensive pass interference. So we're going to pick his flag up, and now we're going to have a flag for illegal forward pass.
Yeah, we could have DH if the receiver is drugged down or just thrown to the ground. If he's legally blocked, so to speak, then there's no DPI, but DH is certainly still a possibility.
Yeah, you could have holding. Yes, you could have holding. Fourth and 12 from K's 25. K's punt first touches R22 at R's 40. So real quick, so when you take the exam, I recommend that you have a blank field diagram with you. You can have one piece of paper, a blank piece of paper with a field diagram. And for these type of questions, I recommend that you get your pencil out and you kind of diagram this. So we got the snapping from case 25. They punt it. First touches R22 at R's 40. While R22 is blocking K8, K44 away from the loose ball. Okay. K33 recovers the punt at R's 35. Ruling, K would be awarded a new series. True or false?
False.
True.
Why false? Who said false? Why?
I said false because the way I'm reading it, R22 is blocked into the loose ball.
So while R22 is blocking K44 away from the ball. So I agree that I tried to fix this question and it was difficult. But what I'm trying to say here is that R22 is not being blocked into. Yeah.
Oh, I got you. Okay. Yeah. I see that.
Yeah. So if K44 blocked R22 into the ball, then we would ignore that touching, correct?
Yes.
Yes. But if R22 is blocking K44 and then the ball hits R22, then we do not ignore that touching. It's a hard question to word, and even fixing it, it really didn't really fix it without changing the whole thing of this question. So try to keep the context of the question that was the initial question and fix the wording, but it was still difficult. But the key here is that we have a punt that's touched by R beyond the expanded neutral zone. So we have to know when do we ignore that touching and when does that touching count? And we ignore the touching if R is blocked into the ball, or when's the other time we ignore that touching? If K knocks the loose ball into R. Okay. So if K touches it they first touch it and then the ball hits R, we ignore that as well, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Fourth quarter, seconds remaining, R trailing by 2 points. During K's punt, R33 gives a valid fair catch signal. K40 catches the punt at K's 30.
R40. You said K40. That's R40 catches the punt at K's 30.
Okay, R40. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Ruling. R40 fair caught K's punt. R may attempt a free kick to score 3 points. True or false?
False.
Okay. So why is this false? What makes this not a fair catch?
Because R40 didn't give the fair catch signal.
Right. Is the ball still dead when R40 catches it?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So the down ends, but because R40 did not give the fair catch signal, R is not awarded a fair catch. A23 and B10, this is another one I tried to fix, but it doesn't really work too well. But A23 and B10 simultaneously catch A's forward pass at B's 2. So what happens when opposing players simultaneously catch or recover a ball?
Ball is dead immediately.
Ball is dead. So after both players land inbounds at B's 2, they fall into B's end zone, ruling touchdown. So
balls, that's true. Balls.
Right. So if you know that they're simultaneously catch, if they simultaneously catch the pass at B's 2, that's where the down ends. After the ready for play, snapper A50 places both hands on the ball. A50 then removes both hands from the ball to enter A's huddle. Ruling, dead ball, foul for snap infraction.
True.
Yeah, so the key here is after the ready for play, and he puts both hands on the ball. Now, can you take one hand off?
Yes.
Yes.
Hand on? Right. But he cannot take both hands off the football. Fourth and goal from R's 1. K-12's field goal attempt strikes K-55 in R's end zone and then passes between the uprights. Ruling, successful field goal.
False.
What makes this false?
Because he's in the end zone.
Mm-hmm. So if he wasn't in the end zone, if he was at the 1 yard line and it just ricochets off of his back and goes through the uprights, would that be a successful field goal?
Yes.
Yeah. But if, since he's in the end zone, that makes this a false statement. Next question. Fourth and goal from R's 1. K-12 field goal attempt strikes the umpire in R's end zone and then passes between the uprights. Ruling, successful field goal.
True.
And then we get to laugh at the umpire for a very long time. On the final play of the fourth quarter, with B leading by 7 points, A-12 throws a touchdown pass. B33 is flagged for holding during the down. R may enforce B's penalty on the truck.
Hey, Sean.
You got a hot mic.
I think I got it. Oh. All right. Okay. On fourth play of the final play of the fourth quarter, B leading it by 7 points. A12 throws the touchdown pass. B33 is flagged for holding during the down, ruling A may enforce B's penalty on the try or to start overtime. True or false?
False.
False.
Why is it false?
That carries over with this subsequent kickoff, not succeeding spot.
Right. So on a touchdown pass, A has the there's a penalty by B. A has the option to enforce B's penalty on the try or the succeeding kickoff by rule. But in this case, there is no succeeding kickoff. So their only option is to enforce it on the try, because there was a touchdown. Now, if this was a field goal, say we have a successful field goal to tie the game, on the last play of the fourth quarter, and there's a foul by B, then they do have the option to carry it over to the overtime, because by rule it says the succeeding spot. Yeah. So, and because the reason why, so the background of this is, so they score a touchdown, the game's not tied, correct? Because they're down by 7 points. How many points is a touchdown worth?
Six.
Right. So they've got to convert the try to get to overtime. And so that's why you cannot carry this over. This is the background as to why you can't carry this over to overtime. Because there may not be an overtime. Okay. On the final play of the fourth quarter, with R leading by 3 points, K14 successfully kicks a field goal. During the down, R33 roughs the holder, ruling K may enforce R's foul to start overtime. True or false?
True.
What is the penalty enforcement for roughing the holder?
Yards at automatic first down.
Yes. This is treated, the holder is treated the same as the kicker or the snapper. By definition, what makes a player a holder?
In position to receive a snap.
And?
One knee on the ground.
One knee on the ground. Ball on the ground.
And?
7 yards.
7 yards.
And do they have to kick it?
No.
Yes.
All right, so let's look at the definition here. So rule two, player designation, section 32, article 7. A holder is a player who controls the ball on the ground or on a kicking tee. So do they have to kick it?
No, I mean, sometimes the kick may not get off.
Well, okay, so let's say he's holding the ball on the ground and he gets hit before they kick it. Is that a foul?
No. That's a live ball.
Yeah. No, it's not a foul. So they have to kick it. For him to be a holder, they've got to kick it. Just like for the kicker to be protected, he has to kick it. Now, do they have to kick it for the snapper to be protected?
No.
Because the snapper is protected by formation, whereas the kicker and the holder are protected by what happens during the down, i.e. they kick it. In the first half during a live ball period, unintentional contact occurs between an official and A's head coach in the restricted area. In the second half, A's head coach is flagged for enforcement-like conduct, not ruled flagrant by the covering official. Ruling, A's head coach is ejected. True or false?
False.
False.
What makes this false?
Because the first one's not a unsportsmanlike foul.
Non-player personal. Rule.
All right. So we have a non-player personal foul, and then we have a non-player unsportsmanlike foul. So what if the official ran into the head coach again in the restricted area later on in the game?
Ejection.
Because that would be his second non-player personal foul, correct? Yeah. So does everybody understand why he's not ejected in this case, even though he's gotten 2 15-yard penalties?
Yep.
Okay, because one's a personal foul, not one's a non-player contact personal foul, and the second one is a non-player unsportsmanlike foul. And so those are not combined in this case.
Quick question for clarification.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, quick question. So at that point, we've got one of each. So at this point, does either one, again, the second one of either one of those calls for an ejection?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, so if he got a second unsportsmanlike, then he would be ejected for 2 unsportsmanlikes. If he got a second non-player personal foul for, you know, unintentional contact, then he would get ejected for that.
Okay, thanks.
And what if it was intentional contact on the first one?
Would be ejected.
He would be ejected for intentional contact.
Hey, yes. Garrett, I got a question.
Yep.
Let's say he got 2 unintentional. Wasn't the head coach? It was 2 different assistants. Does the head coach get ejected?
No.
No?
No. If you can identify who those assistant coaches were, then you they would be charged to those coaches.
Okay.
Yeah. Team A's head coach requests a timeout to discuss a rule application. Following the conference, the ruling is changed. Team A is charged with a team timeout. Because we changed the ruling, they get a timeout. Can Team A request a conference when they don't have any timeouts remaining?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. So still give them their timeout. I mean, still give them their conference. Even if they don't have any timeouts remaining. Now, if you don't change the rule, it's a penalty. But they still
delay game.
Delay game.
It's a delay game, but they still can discuss a rule application. You know, have a conference. There are timeouts. And then the rule of thumb that we've always used. So let's say you have a conference. You don't change the ruling, then we would charge Team A with a timeout, but we still give the team that timeout. So he still gets a chance to talk with his team. So you would give him a 60-second timeout following the conference if we charge them with that timeout.
Hey, Gary,
yep.
as a wing official, should we inform that coach that, you know, if he doesn't have any timeouts, and he wants the conference that, hey, if we don't change this rule, you will be penalized?
Nope. I don't. If he wants the conference, just let him have the conference. And then if we don't change it, then I'll tell him, the referees can tell him, you know, what the result of that is. Because what will happen is if you try to tell him all of that, he's going to come back and say, you know, well, you told me that I couldn't take it or I couldn't have a conference.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's just, if he doesn't know that, then that's his own fault. In terms of not knowing the rules. So if he wants a conference, just we'll give him the conference, and then we'll deal with the aftermath following that conference.
All right. Thanks.
Yeah.
Gary.
Yep.
Let's go back to Anthony's question about the unintentional contact.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I'm looking at that, and I think
the rule says that the second offense, the head coach is gone. It doesn't say that the offense had to be on him.
Even when we can identify who it is,
it just says first offense 15 yards, second offense 15, and disqualification of the head coach.
Okay.
Yeah, because the head coach should be controlling his sideline.
Yeah, okay. Right. That's the way I interpret it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I stand corrected then. So if we go back to that, what was that? Was that the first 14? Question? No, I'll talk about the very first one.
Oh.
So the question number three right here. Okay. So during a dead ball period, Team A's assistant coach is flagged for unsportsmanlike conduct due to cursing the officials. This is Team A's second unsportsmanlike conduct during the game. The first was assigned to the head coach.
No, that's still right, though, because this is unintentional contact versus unsportsmanlike conduct.
Okay.
So, no, I agree that if we can identify which coach we tagging for the unsportsmanlike conduct, that's not going to send the head coach off. But this the unintentional contact, they specifically say – if there's a second one, he's gone. I don't think it matters who the official ended up.
Who did? Okay. I'm all right. So if you know, so question 14 here. So unintentional contact between the official and the head coach occurs. That's one. And then later in the game, you have unintentional contact between an assistant coach of A and the official. That's the second one. Head coach is ejected. Is that what we're saying?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree. Okay. Assistant coach, you mean non-player, so it could really be theoretically anybody.
Anybody, yeah. True.
However, you can still disqualify the or eject the assistant coach if needs be, like not necessarily on that one in and of itself, but a separate incident, correct?
Yes.
Well, anybody can get ejected if you feel like it's flagrant.
Right.
Especially those band members.
So
oh my God, you beat me to it.
So the key here for the winger guys is control your sidelines, right? So if we establish early in the game, if we do the Doug Drenning, for those of you that remember Doug, and we have the sideline warning after the first play of the game, that they will respond. But if you allow them to keep creeping and creeping and creeping, next thing you know, they're going to be standing right behind you, you know, on the field of play. So early in the game, early in the season, really set the tone that coach, you know, the head coach is responsible for keeping them back. And, you know, we use the sideline warning and kind of go from there. And that will help hopefully prevent these situations from happening. And what we can't have is you can't have one official locking down his sideline and the other wing letting his sideline do whatever they want. Because then you start getting, they become like two-year-olds, where it's like, well, he's getting such and such, and why am I not getting that? So if we have to be consistent on both sidelines and really push them back, because it's a safety issue for us. Any more questions about that? Okay. During the first series of overtime, A34 fumbles. B63 recovers and advances to B30 where he fumbles. A82 recovers and is down at B30. Ruling. Team A is awarded a new series, or the ball is dead when B63 recovers the fumble.
Me.
Austin.
Well, yeah. So as soon as B recovers, The ball is dead. The ball is not dead when A34 fumbles. Okay. Don't blow it dead while it's loose. But if B63 recovers a fumble or B63 or B gains possession during the down and overtime, then the ball is dead and the series ends. In the first quarter, B44 intercepts A's pass and returns for a touchdown. During the play, the line judge drops a flag after running around Team B personnel who have entered the restricted area. This is B's first violation of the restricted area ruling. What's the answer to this question?
B.
B is in Bravo. So this is a not. This is a sideline warning, right? Because we don't have contact. He ran around them. There's no contact. B is violated. The restricted area. But this is non-player. So, the touchdown is going to count. And then you're going to have a sideline warning because this is their first offense.
What if he's standing on the field and you run around him?
Did he participate in any way?
Non-player.
Yeah. If he's a non-player, then it's enforced from the seceding spot. And so a sideline warning, we throw a flag. It's treated like a foul with no yardage in terms of penalty enforcement. The penalty is this is your warning to get to stay in your area. R32 catches K's punt at R3, and his momentum takes him into R's end zone. He initially avoids K40 and then takes a knee with the ball in the end zone. Ruling, R will next put the ball in play at
A.
Yeah, so we have the momentum. So when does momentum take effect?
Inside the five.
Right, and it applies to catching a punt, right? Interceptions. Does it apply to recovering a loose ball?
Like round a kick? Yes.
Yeah. So if they recover or they catch inside, they're three and their momentum takes them in. And now can he run around in the end zone?
Yeah.
And still get the momentum exception?
Yep.
When does he lose the momentum exception?
When he comes out.
When he comes out.
Or if he fumbles.
If he fumbles in the end zone and recovers it,
does he still get the field of play?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. In the field of play. All right. Now, let's say he doesn't get out, but the entire ball gets out of the end zone. He doesn't know the rule. He reaches out. So he thinks he needs to get out. He doesn't, but he thinks he does. And he's going to get tackled. He reaches out and the entire ball gets out of the end zone. Where will R put the ball next in play at? Are they going to get the momentum or are they going to get that dead ball spot?
Dead ball spot.
Dead ball, yeah. Yep.
Gary, I was just going to say, I bring up in my pregames now. Larry had a play, it had change of possession and some fumbles in the end zone and stuff, but something like it that I like to tell my crews that, let's say A snaps from the A3 and they fumble it, and the question, say it's worded like it, or they snap from the 5, A quarterback A3 fumbles at the A3, a teammate A2 recovers there, and his momentum takes him into that end zone. It's just something that they could trick you up with. And even a crew of 8 very stellar officials almost flubbed it on a big time TV game. But, the moral of that is the momentum, you said, does it apply to a loose ball? Yes, it does. If the loose ball is is from the other team.
Okay. So,
yeah.
So what Brian is alluding to here is going back to what the safety. Okay. So in the scenario he just gave, who put the ball in the end zone?
A.
Yes. And A was responsible for putting the ball in their own end zone, right?
Yes.
In this situation, K's punt is caught at R3. And so it's unrealistic. Let's say R is running back, catches it over his shoulder. It's unrealistic to expect R to be able to stop that fast and not go into his end zone. And so that's what this momentum exception allows for. It allows for R or B to recover or catch, a pass or a fumble, or recover a fumble from the opposing team and not be penalized with a safety, basically. How do we mark momentum? What do we use to mark momentum when it occurs on the field?
Beanbag.
What color?
White. Black or white?
Mm-hmm. Honestly, anything. I just need a beanbag. Because why do we need a beanbag there? What's the reasoning for that?
So you know where to go back to.
Get out of the kick.
Right. But what else is momentum? What else is that spot used for? It'd be a penalty enforcement. Mm-hmm. Yep. So that's why we need it there.
You need to be careful about that too, because the defense is the one that has to put it in the end zone. If you have a play where A and B change a couple of times, it's only the defense inside the five. It doesn't matter whether it's A or B, it's defense.
That's correct. That's a good point, Ron. But if you go back to your definitions, we talk a lot about A or B, but the team with the ball with possession is what team?
A.
Team last in possession.
Team last in possession. Yeah. So let's look at. So that's going back into, so if you look in Rule 2, Section 43, team designations, the offense is the team which is in possession of the ball. The opponent is the defense. Okay. A is a team which puts the ball in play. The opponent is the opponent is B. And K is a team which legally kicks the ball during the down. The opponent is R. So if you have a change of possession during a down, A and B do not change, right? A put the ball in play, B's the opponent. However, offense and defense can change during the down. So in this case, go back to the play. So where were we? Let me go ahead. So K is the team that put the ball in play. And so R is the opponent. Okay. But if there's a change of possession during the down, then when R catches the ball and they have possession, have they become the offense at this point?
Yes.
Yes, by definition.
But there still are.
But there still are. So don't assume. So if when we're doing penalty enforcement, and when we're communicating, don't say the offense committed holding. I need to know A or B, or white or blue. I need to know what the team is, because the offense is not always the same throughout the down. Does that make sense for everybody?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah, just don't automatically assume that offense and defense, because that can change. It's a very good point, Ron.
Yep, great point. I mean, that is penalty enforcement 101. We know that if it's a change of possession, the team B is now offense at that point. We know that face mask or something, that's the nature of it. Seceding spot, tag it on.
Mm-hmm. Yep. All right, 4th and 16 from R30. K is in a legal scrimmage kick formation with K11 positioned to be the holder and K2 positioned to be the kicker. K11 takes the snap and is downed at R20. R66 is flagged for roughing the snapper. K accepts R's foul, ruling down distance yard line at the next snap will be
B.
Why B?
Because it's a roughing foul and it was during the snap. Previous spot.
So by rule. So what type of play is this? Is this a loose ball play or a running play?
Running play.
Running play. So normally, what is the basic spot for a foul by B on a running play?
End of the run.
End of the run. So this is an exception to that. By rule, this penalty is enforced from the previous spot. So it would be, so if they, and reason why they accept the foul is because they didn't reach the line of the game. It was 4th and 16 from R30. They only got to the 20. So they're going to accept the foul. They're going to go 15 yards from the previous spot. And does this include automatic first down?
Yes. Yes.
I would have gotten this wrong up until this year.
Me too.
Yeah. I would have gotten this wrong.
I would have said 10, the 10 yard line. He thought it was running.
So this is just one of these things we just have to memorize, that roughing the snapper is enforced from the previous spot. And roughing the kicker and holder, that are always going to be enforced in the previous spot because that's during a loose ball play. And the basic spot is the previous spot for a loose ball play. But for roughing the snapper, because they don't have to kick it, doesn't necessarily have to be a loose ball play. That's why we have to remember that this is an exception if it occurs during a running play. All right. 4th and 15 from case 33. During case punt, R42 shields his eyes with one hand without waving his arm. R42 recovers the loose ball at R25 and advances to R39. Ruling. R's ball, 1st and 10 at the 39, 1st and 10 at the 25, or 1st and 10 at the 20.
Hey.
Hey.
All right. So back judges, what do we instruct returners to do? How do we instruct them to shield their eyes?
Well, no movement.
All right. So they can put one hand up. They can shield their eyes, they can put it over their eyes. As long as they don't wave their arm or their hand, then they're okay. Right. And, early in the season, it's still going to be light outside for about first 30 minutes or so. Kickoff is at 7:30 at the varsity level. So it should be light for first 30 minutes or so. So this is something that back judges will need to instruct the returners to do initially, at least at a minimum on the first punt. But it's probably not a bad idea to do it on every punt as long as the sun is out. Fourth and 10 from R35. K2's punt does not cross the neutral zone. While kick in flight, R49 signals for a fair catch at R36. R27 recovers the grounded loose ball and advances for a touchdown. What's the ruling on this?
D is
in dog. The down ends when R recovers the kick?
Yes.
Why does the down end?
Because the signal was given.
And the signal was given where?
36.
Which is where on this play?
Behind.
Oh, behind, my bad.
Yeah, does it matter where the signal is given?
No.
Can, let's say R49 caught it at R36. Can R be awarded a fair catch in this case?
No.
Why can they not be awarded a fair catch?
Past the neutral zone.
Okay. Because the signal was behind the neutral. So, again, so we had the signal. So if R gives a signal and then they recover the kick or they catch the kick, the down ends, the ball is dead. But then we have criteria for R being awarded a fair catch. And why is it, what are the two main benefits to R getting a fair catch?
Lateral placement.
Lateral placement, yep.
Free kick.
Yep.
Protection.
Yep. That's a good point. So R49 gives the signal. Okay. R26 recovers it or catches it. Is R27 catches it, recovers it. Is R27 protected?
No.
Now, we're going to blow it dead. But he could still be contacted. You know, they can't use unnecessary roughness, but he's not, he can still be contacted, basically, from that standpoint. Yeah, so lateral ball placement, the opportunity to attempt a free kick, and then protection for the player that gives the signal. Those are the benefits. B88 contacts A's 11 knee.
Hey, Gary, I got a question on that also.
Yeah.
Can you have kick catching interference if it's behind the neutral zone?
No.
Okay.
Did everybody have the answer to that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And the answer was?
No.
No, you cannot have it. You cannot have it. On a scrimmage kick, can you have it on a free kick that's in the neutral zone?
Yes.
Yeah.
Neutral, yes.
Yep. B88 contacts A's 11 knee with his shoulder while A11 throws a legal for a pass. Is this a foul in high school?
No.
This is not a foul in high school. And we just, if this happens to you in a game and a coach questions it, just say, coach, in high school, this is not a foul. He is not, there's no, it's nothing else to say. Just say, coach, in high school, it's not a foul. First and 10 from A's 18. A32 fumbles at A's 20. And while the ball is loose, A89 bats the ball at A's 25. A66 recovers and is down at A's 15. So first of all, is this a legal or illegal bat?
Illegal.
So we got a foul. Okay, so we got that much down. Does this foul occur during a loose ball play or a running play?
Loose.
Okay, the ball was snapped at the 18, and A's 18, and then the fumble occurred at A's 20. So So was this a fumble in or behind the neutral zone or beyond the neutral zone?
Beyond running play.
Yeah, so this was a fumble beyond the neutral zone. So a fumble beyond the neutral zone, that's during a running play. So what's the basic spot for this play?
The 20.
End of the related run.
The end of the, yep. End of the, so that would be the 20. Okay. So the foul by A occurred at age 25. So are we going to force that foul from the 25 or the 20?
20.
Yeah. Why is that?
Because it's all but one.
Right. So the foul occurred beyond the basic spot. The foul by A was beyond the basic spot. So we go back to the basic spot when that happens. And then A66 recovers and is down at A15. When A66 recovers, does that start a new running play?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, it does. So when we have a fumble by A, how do we mark the end of the run in this play?
Beanbag.
And we need to get it. We don't have to get it to the spot of where he fumbled it. We need to get it to the yard line that he fumbled on. So you don't have to throw your beanbag right at him. Okay. But you got to get your beanbag to the somewhere on the 20-yard line, if that makes sense. So don't be like, you know, you don't have to just throw it in the huddle, you know, in the mass of humanity there. Just drop it on the 20 to indicate. And so that way we know we can find it and we know the spot for penalty enforcement there. And this is another one of those plays where when you're taking the test, it's really helpful to have a piece of paper. And so you could, with the football diagram on it, and there's a diagram that's on the website that you can download and print off. But what I would do on this question is I would say, all right, they're snapping. So A is 18. I'd put an X or something to indicate that's where the ball was snapped from. And then when they fumble, probably put like a circle to indicate the fumble. And then there's a foul at the 25. So then I would star that to indicate that for the penalty. So then I'm looking at a piece of paper and I can see the fumble was beyond the line of scrimmage. The foul was beyond the basic spot. So now it's all visualized for me instead of trying to mentally process in your head. So I definitely recommend that as a test strategy. Fourth and 12 from case 40. Case 44's punt is caught by K88 behind the neutral zone. K88 is tackled inbounds at R's 45. So who's going to be awarded a new series at the end of this, at the end of the down?
Hey.
Team legal possession.
Yeah, so it's fourth and 12 at case 40. K88 punt is caught behind the neutral zone. So can K advance this?
Yes.
Yes. And he reaches the 45. R is 45. So how many yards did he gain?
15.
So he reached the line to gain. So K is going to be awarded a new series. He's tackled inbounds. So is the game clock going to start on the ready or the snap?
Snap.
Why will it be the snap?
Legal kick.
Series after a legal kick.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. So this is another one where, because, you know, we got the 50-yard line and we've got case 40, R's 45. Draw it out. Just draw it out. That way you don't think he only got 5 yards when he actually got 15. Guys is mentally trying to process all that. So
is this 25 or 40, guys?
Was that?
Is this 25 or 40?
Yeah, 25.
What, Brian?
Ryan's asking, just talking, what's on the play clock, 25 or 40?
Okay. Sorry. Yeah, it'd be 25 seconds. Yeah.
Hey, Garrett, I suppose that was a third down play.
Well, what would we do with the game clock then?
The game clock? Oh, yep. You're going to do the same thing.
Same thing. Yep, same thing. Now, let's change it just a little bit. Let's say it's third and 10. A throws an interception. B fumbles it. A recovers it in bounds. You going to award A a new series?
Yes.
What are you going to do with the game clock then?
Wind it.
Why are you going to wind it?
Ready for play. It's a new series, but it was not after a legal kick, so you wind it. Right.
And he was and the down ended
in bounds.
In bounds. Yep. In bounds. Yep. Yep. All right. Last one for tonight. Fourth and one from K's 23. R10 touches K's punt behind the neutral zone. K24 recovers the kick at K's 28 and is tackled at K's 31. What do we got?
C.
Got first touching.
That first touching is ignored.
Why?
All right. So we snapped it from the 23. R10 touches K's punt behind the neutral zone. Do we ignore that touching by R?
Yes.
Okay. K24 recovers the kick at K's 28.
That's so the first touching.
So did K recover the kick in or behind the neutral zone?
No.
No, they recovered beyond. So what happens when K recovers a kick beyond the neutral zone?
Well, dead.
It's dead, right? And then, so then we know it's dead. So then, is there any reason why K would be awarded a new series during this play? Did anything happen?
No.
So that's why R would be awarded a new series, first and 10 at K's 28. Any questions about that one?
Garrett.
Yep.
I just got a test taking guidance, if you would.
Yeah.
Whenever I take the test, I usually read sentence by sentence. Say, for an example, question number 25, fourth and one from K's 23. Okay. We know we're going to potentially have a kick here. R10 touches K's punt behind the neutral zone. I process that next sentence. Okay. I process the next sentence. We know that touching behind neutral zone is ignored. So we're good to go so far, correct? So K24 recovers the kick at the K28 and is tackled at K31. So if you process one sentence after another, I think that will help tremendously whenever you're taking a test. Rather than trying to read the entire question, process what the question is asking you. Whenever you're taking a test, if you'll take it sentence by sentence, that will help out tremendously, not only with the drawing the diagram out if you need to, but if you take it sentence by sentence, that will help processing and understanding what the question is ultimately asking.
And really, Len, that's what we should be doing on the field too in a complicated play like this.
Absolutely.
So if this happened on the field, our conversation should be, okay, we had fourth and one. KR touched it behind the neutral zone. We don't have anything with that. K recovered the kick at the 28. They recovered it beyond the neutral zone. The ball is dead. That's the conversation that we need to be having. That's the process we need to be working through as a crew on the field. So while that, you know, yes, Lynn is exactly right. Break it down, but we should be doing the same process. Should be used on the field as well. Does anybody else have any good test taking tips
The only other thing I can think of
I don't mark my Scantron sheet until I know what answer I'm given, so that there's no chance that something that I changed my mind and erased, that the Scantron picks up what I erased and not what I really answered. Because even though we have people reviewing it after the fact, it can be missed.
Yeah, right all over the test. Okay, right all over the test all day long. And if they tell you can't write on the test, ignore them and write on the test. All right. Make all the marks you want on the test. Save the Scantron until the very end.
Garrick, something that helps, and I told our little small group the other night, whenever you've got to play and they offer you about half of the ones that we were doing just said, you know, we've got a simultaneous catch and they didn't even offer a yard line. But when they do, look at where you're going. That's Bostic will tell you, Moffrey will tell you that even fourth and one here, if I write 24 above that 23, I know we're going downfield the other way. So 24, I can take myself to the 28 and say, all right, boom, that's beyond the neutral zone. Okay, recover it there. But even on a regular scrimmage play, third and 12 from the 28, we know we've got to get to the 50. The just doing that puts in your mind where you've got to go, where we are on the field, and I think it helps visualize better.
See, Sam Davis on here, he normally does pretty well on the test. Sam, what sort of test tips do you have for everybody? All right, maybe Sam didn't quite figure out the mute button yet. Dimery.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I got you, Sam. Yeah, I got you.
Okay. If you ever decide to skip a question, make sure you keep in line with the number of the question along with the number of what's going on the Scantron sheet. It's very easy to get confused. And if you do, then sometimes it's real hard to straighten it out.
Yep. Yep. We've seen that happen.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And make sure you start off on the right side of the Scantron. Don't start out with 50, question number one.
Yeah.
Very good.
All right. So that's what we got for tonight. We'll do the next 25 questions Thursday night. And then if there are any other plays or any other topics that you want extra covered, you can either email me before then and I can put something together. Or we can just talk about it as a group Thursday night. And then I think, you know, I sent out, I'll do as many questions as you can. We got, 16 quizzes on the website. We've got multiple practice exams. Take them in groups, you know, do them individually, whatever works best for you. But just doing questions. And then if you don't know something, don't just skip it. Go look it up. And if you're having trouble finding the rule, reach out to me, Brian, Sam, Demery, John, a whole bunch of people. Reach out to us and we'll help you find the rule and everything and kind of explain it.
Jay, can I add one more thing? This is Sam.
Mm-hmm.
Can I add one more thing?
Yeah.
Be sure that when we read the question, just read what the question says. Don't guess, don't add to it, don't do anything else other than just what the question says.
I will say that the test is being written by the executive committee this year. They heard the critiques from last year in terms of length and everything. So that what I've been told is being addressed with this exam. And then for our new officials, you'll be taking a different exam that's similar to the Federation exam. And the quizzes are good practice for that because a lot of our quizzes came from the Federation exam last year. I got my hands on a copy of it. And so I was able to use a lot of those questions for the quizzes. So if you're a new official and you're kind of struggling on some of the practice exams, go to the quizzes, do the quizzes, and make sure that you kind of have an understanding of your definitions and your fundamentals. You know, if I can't stress that enough, definition of fundamentals, and then you'll be okay next Saturday. All right. Does anybody else have anything for the good of the group? Well, all right, guys. Well, y'all have a good night.